Thank you, Sabine. It's great to be here. I was a little bit nervous last night when I got an email from Sabine telling me to cut my talk in half. not really, I'm kidding a little bit, but she reminded me that we have limited time for this, and so I did have to slice a few things, including some of the cartoons, quotes, and the other silly stuff. But I did want to ask if anybody recognized this. Very good, I'm very impressed. It's hard to recognize, but this actually resides at my campus, the University of Texas. It's the earliest surviving photograph, which was actually recorded on pewter with a chemical coating. And I just thought that people in this crowd should know about this. You know, it's where it all started, right? This is an engineering enhancement of it. Maybe you've seen this one before. So I'll be talking about dimensions of visual quality, and each one of these will be a little bit of a vignette rather than an in-depth study, with a little bit of an exception on the question of blind image quality, which is what we're focusing on right now. So first of all, full reference QA, I'm going to kind of take a position that is a little bit controversial, perhaps. This being a plenary, I get to do that. That the full reference still image problem is essentially solved. For those that haven't studied this, what I mean by full reference is basically you make a comparison between the image that you are assessing with some pristine reference image. Okay, so basically your algorithm is a comparative algorithm which might embed things like perceptual principles. What I'll be talking about later is the blind problem or no reference problem where all you have available is that distorted image and your algorithm has to work only with that. There are algorithms in between, but I'm not going to talk about those today. So the observation I'm going to make is that this problem is kind of stalled, the still image full reference problem. There hasn't been much progress recently, and I think we've actually reached a point where it can be argued that we're coming close to or even almost achieving human performance on this problem. We have tried for years since coming up with this idea of the SIM index, which here I say it's, dominant paradigm, but I admit freely that it was, largely, 10% inspiration and 90%, good luck or accident. And this is something we've published before in the past. It shows a correlations of a variety of algorithms against human subjective judgments in a rather large study where we collected, some 25,000 judgments. And the important thing here is, to observe, as we've done a number of times, that the mean squared error, PSNR, is not an effective measure as compared to other algorithms which embed other kinds of principles which are primarily perceptually relevant. Okay. So these correlations, of course, the correlations you get depend on the database, but a long time ago we studied what would be the sort of upper limit if, in other words, if we took a set of humans in and we called that set of humans an algorithm and performed the correlation against these subjective judgments, it would be around 0.98. On a very huge database, similar kind of results were attained for these algorithms that we had developed, and even worse results for the sort of mean squared error. And so we didn't compute an upper bound on this database, but we're still getting up towards 0.9 there, and maybe this is close to an upper limit on this database. The message here, of course, is, and I keep saying this because I keep reading papers where PSNR is used for measuring the results of somebody's algorithm, is that it's just not a very good measure to use at all. So we've spent a lot of time, as have others, in trying to improve on quality metrics in general. In our case, we usually start with this algorithm. And we found that, such obvious things as saying, well, it depends on where you're looking. So if we do eye tracking studies and try to predict fixations and weight the quality, that should work, and it doesn't improve it noticeably, not by any statistical degree. If we find a place, I don't know if you can see this, there's a severe error right here. So, you know, if there's a severe error somewhere spatially, does that do it? No, it doesn't really improve it. If we try to measure content like edges and texture and stuff and that we think are sort of perceptually relevant, it doesn't improve it. And in fact, only by one method did we get an improvement, which actually comes close to that human performance. It's something I very recently did with Christophe Charrière and Larry Maloney and Ken Knobloch. And that's just to optimize the original coefficients on the multi-scale SIM index using a technique called maximum likelihood difference scaling that Larry Maloney had developed. And so we think at this point that problem is not going to go much further. Okay? So next little vignette is a full reference video quality assessment. Okay? Anybody recognize this one? There you go. Okay, this is the horse in motion. It's the first video. Okay, I thought you can Google these things and find them, of course. So I'm not going to survey the video quality indices that are out there at all. I'll just point out that I think that, you know, there is still room for improvement here because there are more perceptual attributes that might be brought to bear than the very simple ones that have been used so far, including by ourselves. You know, area V1 and area MT models have been used and that sort of thing, optical flow. But, you know, I think there's still room for improvement in terms of, you know, maybe accounting for things like ego motion and more complex motions and that sort of thing. Okay, but I think we're going to be approaching a plateau on this comparative problem. And this is also a comparison problem, but now we have the time dimension. Pretty soon, where we'll say, okay, we're not making much progress. Right now, I think the most promising direction is one that we're pursuing, and that is, what is the behavioral response to videos? And in particular, others have observed in the past that if a video has some very severe distortions in it, a good example is like a packet loss, so you know, suddenly have a lousy video. I went searching on my laptop and found one, if it'll come up. So here's a video, and then, you know, there's this transient distortion. And once you see that, you know, okay, this is a lousy video from that point. And we've gone a little bit further to hypothesize that this is a sort of, really it's a hysteresis effect. In other words, once that occurs, you know, the subject viewing it, the person viewing the video has a memory of this, okay, and he's hesitant to, if he's, you know, doing a continuous recording of quality, either with his hand or just in his mind, he's not ready to return to, you know, saying this is a high quality video until maybe a longer period of time has passed of a lot of good quality. And then he'd say, well, okay, or he or she would say, okay, that was just a very unusual event. So we have a very large video quality database out there where we've published that and used it for our video quality studies in the past. This work was done by Kalpana Seshadriathan of Intel, formerly of our lab. But we all, you know, in that study, we collected scores at the end. We said, rate this whole video. But we also collected continuous quality scores. So the subject would continuously record the quality of the video, okay, as they went. We hadn't used that before, but we did recently. And we've observed, and these are highly consistent effects, that if the algorithm detects, or an algorithm detects, or the human detects a sudden loss of quality, okay? So this is the algorithm in dotted lines. It's saying, okay, good quality, boop, terrible event here, some packet loss or something. And then the algorithm returns when the quality returns. Well, the human isn't so ready to forgive. And this occurs, you know, in over half the videos in the database, we see this sort of phenomena occurring, okay? So, naturally, there's no mathematical model for this behavioral thing. This is not even really as simple as a perceptual thing that we're trying to model. It's behavioral. So we came up with a very simple approach where we said, well, let's just have a moving window that studies the video. And at the current moment, we'll look at the past over a time interval tau, and we'll see what was the worst score delivered by an algorithm. Okay, and we'll also look at the future. And we'll say, well, does that distortion persist, or does it come to an end? Is it a transient kind of distortion? And we'll use this to weight these two elements of a quality score. So we embed a memory into the quality index. So this is our starting index. Our new index has a memory element embedded in it. When we do this, we took a couple of our algorithms, which are the SIM index, just applied on frames, and the recent algorithm called the movie index, which performs very well. And we found that using this simple algorithm against human subjective judgments significantly improves performance. And I mean, you know, statistically significantly. And this is a very tough database, the live video quality database. And, you know, we've been, this is a very good score to obtain. Okay, so next vignette in these various dimensions is blind image quality assessment. Still images is what we've been succeeding at this point. You know, this has been an important problem for a very long time, one which, you know, people I think really regarded for at least the first two decades of my own career as something you just couldn't hope to do. But back then, there weren't very good perceptual models. And the field known as natural scene statistic modeling, which I attribute to people like Stefan Malat and some psychologists, hadn't really come about. So in the blind area, there are quite a few algorithms that assess single known distortions. And this is not what I'm going to talk about. These are important. You know, an algorithm that says, OK, the JPEG blockiness is this bad is important. It's just we're interested in very general algorithms that, you know, can assess maybe not every distortion, but at least a broad spectrum of distortions. This would, if we could do it, it would be immensely useful. You can imagine, you know, on YouTube, you know, upload it, and it tells you what's the quality of that visual signal. So it's important because, you know, first of all, I've never seen a pristine reference signal. So the whole idea of full reference to me is fundamentally flawed. Secondly, you usually don't have it in useful applications. It's good for benchmarking if you're coming up with a denoising algorithm, but it's very limited otherwise. Okay? And furthermore, you quite often don't know the distortions. Okay? You'd like to have an algorithm that's in a switch or a router that can maybe assess what's coming in the incoming stream, and you don't know what that distortion is going to be. So if you can do the blind problem, it'll be a much larger application domain. And what really pushes my button is when Cisco came to us in Intel with the results of this report, where they feel that, you know, the wireless video traffic over the next 5 years is going to increase by, you know, close to two orders of magnitude. 100 times the video traffic over wireless. I mean, already you can't use an iPhone in New York, okay? And, you know, the video quality suffers. But, you know, this tells me that, well, we need to do something, and we're out of the mathematical tricks, so we need to start using perceptual methods. And the basis for that will be methods that can measure the quality. Then you can start to optimize with respect to those metrics. So, you know, I have a vision that, you know, algorithms for visual quality, blind algorithms ideally, will be appearing in every device, every switch and router, set-top box, your tablets, laptops, cameras, everywhere, where these adapt and can learn and assess the statistics of videos and distortions, and I'll be talking about statistics soon, which are based on perceptual principles over the entire, you know, infinite network. So it's a, you know, it's kind of a big vision, but it's started to happen already some, okay? With full reference algorithms, we're seeing, for example, the SIM index is being built into set-top box software. It's part of H.264 now, and so this is starting to happen. But I think there's a broad future in general for this. So back to the blind problem. A couple of observations which are pretty well established. First of all, natural images obey statistical laws. This is a wonderful thing for our problem. Moreover, our visual system has adapted to these laws over the eons. Okay? And there's excellent evidence on both counts, and perceptual modeling, to the extent that perceptual modeling and scene modeling are kind of viewed as duals of each other, even, at least for low level, at least. Okay? So some hypotheses which we have been testing and finding to be valid are that, first of all, distortions of images, which are primarily artificial, modify the natural image statistics in a way that is predictable. And that term predictable is very important. Secondly, that the visual system is sensitive to these modifications. After all, we see the distortions. But by sensitive, I mean that, you know, it's sensitive to a change in the statistics. And thirdly, that we can model and predict this. And this is what I'll be doing going forward. There are a couple of natural scene statistic models that are very simple. There are more complex ones that are Markovian and so on. But we're relying just on very simple ones right now with good success. Both of them start with a receptive field response model, or say a wavelet coefficient model. We have an image, decompose it into wavelet coefficients x, which we model in the first case as a Gaussian scale mixture, meaning a Gaussian multiplied by a variance field, which accounts for structure in the signal in the wavelet domain, which is typically sparse and which accounts for, you know, correlations through that structure. Now, the typical approach then to analysis for various tasks, not just quality assessment, things like denoising and things like that, Eero Simoncelli has done some wonderful work in this direction, is to, you know, find estimates of the variance field, basically divide it out. Okay, this gives you something that's approximately Gaussian and that has been decorrelated to some extent. And this is what's come to be known as a divisive normalization transform. And this, you know, has a little bit of historic precedent. David Heeger studied this phenomena in the cat and, you know, posed it as a model for adaptive gain control. So, you know, it's an older model, but it's one which explains a lot. First of all, I'm not sure if you'd be able to see this from far away, but this has got white noise, and you mostly see it on the face and other smooth regions, but not in the textured areas. And similarly, JPEG, you see it on the face, but you can't see it amongst the flowers and weeds and so on. Okay, so it's a good explanation for masking effect. And it also dramatically improves quality assessment performance of algorithms when it's used with this model. And it's been used for both full reference and reduced reference. And we've been using it for the blind problem. Okay, so basically you know, have wavelet responses which are summed and then divide, you know, this is for over a neighborhood and divide a local wavelet coefficient. Okay, this is a saturation term. The second model is the generalized Gaussian. Okay, also probably familiar. Here, the same receptive field responses or wavelet coefficients are now modeled as obeying something that's not necessarily Gaussian, but more typically has heavier tails, where, you know, beta has an exponent value less than 2. Okay, maybe 1 or somewhere in between or even less. Okay, and this has also been rather exhaustively tested and found to be, you know, an accurate model for natural images. By the way, for those that think that natural images might mean like trees and grass, it includes that, but really anything taken with a camera. So if I took a picture of you guys, that's a natural image of this room. It's a natural image. So this is just an example over a large database, which is testing one of our hypotheses that the distortions predictably modify natural scene statistics. In this case, if we look at this, it changes the shape parameter of the local histograms of wavelet coefficients from images, a large number of images, I think 80 of them, with different kinds of distortions. So we see, you know, different shapes, different sigmas, different falloffs, that sort of thing. So it's a very simple observation, but it's a foundation to begin building statistically oriented blind quality indices. I'm going to show you one. We're actually working on several complementary approaches to the blind problem. They all embed these natural scene models and things like divisive normalization and so on. But this one I thought would be very easy as for this talk where I could, you know, explain it without taking up the whole talk. It's meant to be simple and easy to use. It's a multi-scale, but operates in the DCT domain, and it's very simple. You take the image, break it into blocks, compute DCTs. Within the DC, once you're in the DCT domain, you use a generalized Gaussian model of coefficients. Then you extract a number of features from the histograms that have been fit with that generalized Gaussian model. Okay, I'll describe some of those in brief. And then we do a training and test phase. We train using a simple probabilistic predictor, nothing, no SVDs or anything fancy, just a simple probabilistic predictor. And it's multi-scale because once we do it over three different scales, and that matches naturally multi-scale perception and multi-scale nature of images. So remembering our generalized Gaussian model, we take 5x5 blocks, not overlapping. This is a very simple, and it's intended to be a fast algorithm people might actually use out there in the network, for example, where we then take the DCT of the block, pixel values, and we histogram those over the whole block and also over these sub-blocks. Okay, so I take the histogram of these and these separately, and we fit them all with the generalized Gaussians. And what we're looking for, of course, is within each block a change in the distribution from low to high frequency and over orientations. Okay, and also change over the whole blocks due to distortions. Okay, so I'm not going to explain all the features in great detail, but I've pretty much summarized it, looking for variations in the shape, the parameters of this across orientations and across radial frequencies, and how these things change with distortion. Okay, we come up with 30 features in this way. And what we do to train it is we just model that 30D feature vector as multi-dimensional Gaussian. Overly simple, yes, but it seems to work pretty well. So we fit that, using, I'll talk about our training procedure in a minute. We estimate the parameters of the multidimensional Gaussian. And then once we do that to apply it, well, we just, once a new image comes in, we compute all those features, and we just find, basically a maximum likelihood type approach, okay, maximum a posteriori approach where we maximize the DMOS over that computed feature vector. And there's no reference image here involved at all. By the way, this code for this algorithm is freely available. Just pop me an email. I think we'll have it on our website soon as well. So we use the live database. The first thing is, I'll admit, is that the live database is limited. It has 5 distortions, not all the distortions possible in the universe. So, any claims I make about how good we get is tempered by the fact that, it's only these. Yet these are, I cut off the fifth one. That's our famous fast-fading noise distortion. That was also included. They are fairly representative and diverse, high frequency, low frequency, structured, unstructured, that sort of thing, transient and not. So it's a pretty good database in regards to diversity. Our training and test procedure is we break the database into 80-20 training and test sets, so 23 and 6 images. We do this training procedure I just described 1,000 times, and we report the median performance. Okay, and we found good performance with high degree of consistency, small variance of performance. So in comparing, these are all full reference algorithms, full reference algorithms. Some of them, these are the best full reference algorithms on this database. And this is the algorithm I just described, and you notice across these categories of distortion, it's extremely competitive. It doesn't beat them yet, but it does. It's as good as the SIM index, which has become very popular. Okay, so as I said, we temper this by saying, "Hey, this is on a database." Okay, even though we did this cross-validation procedure, so we don't want to claim too much. But nevertheless, this is at least very promising, and we think that as we continue to evolve these models, we will achieve parity with these kind of algorithms that are full reference, okay? We think the information is there in the signal and in the brain, which we can subsequently model. So for us, this is a standout result. Next vignette, fourth dimension, video quality assessment. This is a problem we started looking at, blind video quality assessment, not too long ago. And while I'm claiming good success in the previous for still images, I'm holding up my hand and saying, so far we surrender on the blind video quality problem. Not that we're really surrendering, but we haven't solved it yet. Now, again, there's distortion-specific blind video quality assessment algorithms, and these are important. Okay, it's just not what I'm talking about. We're talking about the goal, our goal of the general purpose algorithms that we can throw out there that can learn various situations and perform well on all kinds of distortions. And our progress is limited. So the key is statistical regularity of some measure of the natural scene statistics. This is what we're failing to find, and by the way, which others have failed to find. Probably the most sophisticated paper or effort on studying, for example, optical flow fields and their statistics was done by Roth and Michael Black just a few years ago. And they reported some statistical regularity, but only in a very limited scenario where the scene is absolutely static and the camera is allowed to move. So in other words, no independent moving objects at all, nothing that articulates or moves or bends or twists or grows larger or smaller, that sort of thing, no zooming or anything like that. Basically, you know, straight line motion of a camera. And, you know, their admission that they couldn't do more tells me that they couldn't find statistical regularities at all under their model when that assumption was relaxed, okay? We also, you know, we've just started this, but we haven't been able to find them either, either in the original videos or the distorted ones, okay? So I'm admitting that this problem is wide open. Okay, and so have at it, anybody working in this field. Okay. We'd love to hear of your, you know, successes going forward. So that's a short vignette. Okay, last dimension. How am I doing on time, by the way? But when am I supposed to finish? 10 minutes, because Q&A and all that. Okay. So this one I'll talk about a little bit more. This is, you know, it's hot these days, and fascinating. You know, we've been studying stereo for my whole career. Perception of, 3D stereo perception and that sort of thing. But, you know, working in the quality assessment field is really a fascinating place to be because, you know, as an image processor, you know, it presents challenges that are not just the usual theorem and proof, okay? I found as I've transitioned into this field, you know, I've gone from a theorem proof guy into an experimentalist, okay? So, and relying on a lot of, you know, data from others and that, you know, models which are quantitative but based on, you know, curve fitting and that sort of thing. On the perceptual side, distortions are really excellent probes into the visual process, just like visual illusions are, okay? So how do we perceive distortions? That's a question that hasn't really been explored by the, you know, perception and cognition community until very recently where there's been cross, you know, collaborative efforts. There's a few exceptions of people who've done a little bit, but it hasn't been a, you know, big, broad effort. So anyway, back to this problem. This is a problem where you can't dispense with that. So it's very hot, you know. Everybody saw Avatar, and then, you know, suddenly everybody's doing 3D, and they're selling these big 3D screens, you know, and now they're cheap even, you know. This is coming, okay? 3D on your mobile, just a few years. The auto stereoscopic displays are coming along to the point where you'll be seeing it maybe 5-6 years, you know. Every time you estimate something, it turns out to be less. Now there's, you know, cameras that... for both, this is a professional Panasonic stereo cinematic camera. We just bought one of these to acquire content, but you can, the consumer model is also out, so. stereo quality assessment is kind of complicated by other factors. This third dimension and the fact that you have these glasses that you may wear and the geometry, it can really be broken down, I think, into three broad areas, which are sort of, you know, perpendicular to each other, independent of each other. The first is, you know, the question of comfort. A lot of people go see a stereo movie and they get headaches and that sort of thing. Or some stereo movies give everybody a headache, okay? And the question there is, you know, what were the assumptions made in acquisition with the emergence of the cinematic cameras, okay? Does it present something that is naturalistic for a human, okay? So if you take two cameras and you acquire, you know, something of that like that picture there, and you acquire a video of it, and then you supply it to eyes that would be, you know, looking at it like this, you may feel discomfort, eye strain, that sort of thing, because it's not natural for our intrinsic geometry. Okay, so this is an important problem, and it's been studied by a number of people, and it's not one that we're going to emphasize in this talk. We're looking at it a little bit, though. Crosstalk is another issue. This is really a display issue where, you know, you've got this interleaving problem where you'll see one of the, you've got this left-right pair and you only want to see one with one eye, not with the other. And if the display device isn't done properly, then you get this sort of ghosting. I think this is going to be solved. We're not looking at it at all. What we're looking at is something that aligns with what we've been doing, you know. We're going to be seeing these stereo images going down the wireless pipe. They're going to be distorted by classical distortions, packet losses and compression distortions and jitter and all that kind of stuff. Noise, you know, in low light situations. So we're interested in how these kind of distortions are perceived, okay, and whether we can predict that perception. And it has a lot more aspects than the 2D problem. Some of which have never been explored, really, in the vision science literature. There's two classes here, okay? One class has actually received a lot of attention. I would say the French group, Le Calais and Barba and so on, have really pioneered early stereo quality assessment, and they've looked at what I'm just calling the full reference problem. What I mean by that is that you assume you have a pristine stereo pair and then a distorted stereo pair. And then you might, you know, compute depth maps using an algorithm and compare those and compare the pristine and distorted stereo pairs, that sort of thing. What the problem we're trying to approach is the blind problem, where we don't have that pristine stereo pair. We do have a distorted stereo pair, because otherwise you don't have any signal. But and this is the real problem, and I'll say more about that, okay, the blind stereo problem. So we assume no reference signal, but the important thing to remember in stereo perception and stereo quality assessment, you also don't have the distorted perceived signal available. Certainly you have that stereo pair, but by the distorted perceived signal, I mean the cyclopean image that's formed in the brain, the three-dimensional percept, okay? We don't have access to that numerically, unlike in 2D where we have the image that's, you know, that is projected directly onto the retina. So it's a very different problem. It's double blind. We cannot access the stereo experience, in other words, numerically, okay? So we have to guess at that as well. Now, I'm not going to claim any successes yet on this. We are taking a fundamental approach where instead of jumping in and trying to create algorithms, we want to do some science first. So this is what I view as the three steps to success on this difficult double-blind stereo quality assessment problem. First of all, we need some tools. Okay, because rather than relying on algorithms to compute depths, which are always highly questionable, okay, nobody has developed the perfect stereo algorithm, we need a really good databases of ground truth 3D co-registered with the luminance, especially the stereo pairs. Okay. Secondly, and we'll need one to be able to do two, we need successful natural scene statistic models of the third dimension and how it relates to luminance and chrominance. And thirdly, we need better models of 3D stereo perception as it relates to quality assessment. And there are certain directions that we're interested in there. So on the first count, we have made a lot of progress, okay? We are acquiring and have acquired one database already of optical images co-registered with ground truth, very high precision using a LiDAR scanner, which I'll show you in a minute, okay? We modified that scanner, which has a camera that's mounted on it, to have a stereo translational stage as well. Okay, so we are acquiring stereo images at very high resolution with extremely high resolution precision range data. Okay, and we have created a distorted stereo image database. And we'll be publishing all this very soon. I'm not going to describe it in too much more depth, but here's the scanner. The darn thing cost us $250,000, and it's about as big as a coffee can. But it works really great. I highly recommend it if you're interested in, you know, doing these kind of studies. This is the instrument. We did an intensive study of the things out there, and this is the instrument I would purchase. It has a waveform analysis that it does near discontinuities to get better accuracy. And here's the translational stage that we constructed to, so we can, you know, acquire a range map here and here, and also, you know, create a stereo pair. This is blurred a little bit because I expanded it for the PowerPoint slide, but it's not blurry. Very high resolution images acquired with a Nikon camera, and these are left range maps associated with each of those. Okay, so we can get very good co-registered data. So this is, in some sense, this is our range map, and if we assume fixations, we can compute disparity maps, that sort of thing. So this is what we've been doing. We've been using, you know, luminance and range and computed disparity maps to examine the joint and conditional distributions of the co-registered data. Okay, and we've been getting some very interesting results. We're very happy with this aspect of our work. So just as a flavor of this, this shows two-dimensional histograms of co-registered, in this case, on the left, this is co-registered luminance and range data. So this is luminance, this is range, as a 2D plot. And this is where we took a luminance and range from that were independent, not from the same image. Okay, and this is very independent sort of structure. This is a very dependent. It indicates that there's a correlation between the luminance and the range coefficients that are co-registered. Okay, there was never a result like this before. It's intuitive, yes, that there would be some. You know, discontinuities may align and that sort of thing. Okay, and we've established, you know, this dependency using statistical tests, of course, too, with high degree of confidence. This shows a plot over a large database of luminance and range wavelet coefficients over three different bands, blue, green, and red, okay, from low to high bands. And we observe an almost linear relationship between these. So there's some explanation for this, you know, large discontinuity intensity often would be a large discontinuity in depth and so on. Of course, it's not always the case. As far as modeling, we have found that these the conditional distributions of range on luminance or luminance on range can be well modeled by our old friend, the generalized Gaussian distribution. Okay, and so we can use these to do various vision tasks now, one of which going forward, but not yet, is the quality assessment problem in three dimensions. As an early test, we took this model and we modified a well-known Bayesian stereo algorithm simply by adding this as a constraint, that the data follow this prior distribution. And we found a tremendous improvement in performance of Belhemoor's Bayesian stereo algorithm. This shows a few examples. So, you know, on the right side is the original Bayesian algorithm in each case, and on the left side is just by, you know, adding this natural scene statistic constraint. Okay, so we thought that that was very promising. Third aspect is the perceptual studies. I'm almost done, by the way. And these are underway right now. What we are looking at is we have created, I'm not sure you'll be able to see the distortions. There's JPEG 2000 distortion right here and right here in two different places in the left-right images. These are stereo pairs. And in this image, they're in the same place, JPEG 2000 distortions that have been localized. It's not over the whole image, just localized. And basically, we put stereo pairs in front of human subjects who view these stereoscopically, and they're asked to find the distortion. Okay, so they're given a visual task. Ostensibly, that distortion might be hidden by the content, in other words, sort of a classical contrast masking of a distortion, but it also might be hidden by the disparity or the depth content. Okay, there's two ways in which this can happen. There's a classical effect called a, you know, suppression of the distortion stereoscopically. This dates way back to Jules, who observed, you know, you don't see noise. If there's noise in one, you can still fuse, that sort of thing. Or if you blur one, you can still fuse. The idea is being used right now by engineers to create what they call asymmetric codecs. This is an active research area where you, if you have a stereo pair, well, you compress one of the pair more than the other, but the eye will put them together and account for that through a binocular suppression effect. So we wish to quantify this as a function of measurable aspects of the luminance, chrominance, and depth content or disparity content. Okay? The second is a phenomena that has not been explored in the vision science literature, and that is what I've just been describing, disparity masking. Okay? If the disparity is busy, okay, and it is busy right here where this, you know, these leaves are changing in depth rapidly, does that help obscure distortions? Okay? So this is a hypothesis of ours in which we hope to quantify and report before too long. Okay? So we're building an approach to blind natural scene-based stereo quality assessment. Okay? And it'll follow what we've done before, where we, you know, train on these generalized Gaussians using the parameters and so on. We use databases to train on. And we have all these unknowns, you know, the rivalrous, the masking of disparity by luminance and the masking of luminance by disparity and so on and so on. There's various combinations of this, okay? And we think this is the key to understanding this, and we think that we need this vision science before we go out there and just, you know, start making algorithms by dividing by disparity and that sort of thing. Okay, so that's underway. And we've been supported by a lot of companies now who are really interested in this. You know, Intel and Cisco came to us with this 50 to 100 times, and they said, look, we can't solve this. We're scared to death. You know, the iPhone and the droids are going to kill us. So these have been our sponsors. So can you see the effect? Yeah, I call this the nauseator. Was I okay on time, I think? Yeah.
I'm not sure it's a question, but rather a comment. I think that the reference algorithms still have a very good use, and that is in the broadcast end. You have the original, you're going to suppress, compress, you do whatever you want, and you use the algorithm to determine whether you really should go there. So I think
they are being used there. Yes. I mean, research is coming to a... My point is really more on the research is, you know,
because you said that
brick wall kind of, you know. I agree, though, and it is being used, you know, the full reference algorithms are being used that way. Unfortunately, PSNR is still being used more than anything.
Yes.
That's what it is.
Yeah. Ken Loggery, Vision Media. You have indicated many things in the blind area that you wish you had information on. Perhaps you're one of the most significant people to provide the system designers with the parameters that they need to transmit, so you'll have your references.
Not sure I fully understand. So,
in other words, everyone would love to have stereo transmission of television, movies. Potentially, the coding efficiency between a left image and a right image, once you have fully all the information in one, perhaps another 5% gives of the informational content gives you the second image. Mm. Now, when you have a reference to work with, life is much better. Mm. But when you have a blind situation, you wish you had a reference. So my suggestion to you is, you know what information you would ideally like to have. Mm. Please provide it to the people who are designing the systems so that they will make it available to you.
Yeah. There is, you know, information. That's kind of in the head direction of what we call reduced reference, where there's some kind of information you might have available. Even if you don't have the video itself, you might have information about, you know, bit rate and, you know, this kind of stuff. So certainly that should be able to help ostensibly. I'm not sure that we want to have the reference, though. I'm going to throw that one out there because I think ultimately maybe the reference isn't going to be necessary.
Well, let me just say that if the future systems will have a lot of correction capability, if you had the reference to provide the intelligent clues, the intelligent correction would make it better image quality and you'd have less distortion.
I will admit that.
Thank you.
Yeah. Okay, thank you. In the interest of time, I think we'll close the question session.
Thank you.
Now, before you take off, can I just have your attention one more or two more minutes? Because there's actually one more award, or actually two more awards that we would like to give. Now, the SPIE and ISNT, or actually the community of electronic imaging, every year honors a scientist of the year. We ask you, our attendees, usually for nominations, and again, this year we got many, many good nominations. Now, independent of our invitation of the plenary speakers, it turned out that the EEI Steering Committee voted for this year, actually, and see, he doesn't even know. This is why he's turning around and putting his computer away. Al Bovic as the Electronic Imaging Scientist of the Year. So, his plaque reads, the Electronic Imaging Scientist of the Year is awarded to Alan C. Bovic for his seminal contributions to the computational aspects of biological visual perception, specifically in the areas of image and video quality. Congratulations.
Right. Thank you so much. Oh, boy. Okay. I don't have anything to say, so... I definitely don't have any comments prepared. Thanks very much. This is a tremendous honor. Thank you so much, Sabine, and whoever.